أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله أوله بلا أول كان قبله وآخره بلا آخر يكون بعده الذي قصرت عن رؤيته أبصار الناظرين وأجزت عن نعته أوهام الواسفين ثم الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا حبيبنا وطبيب نفوسنا أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين ولعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم وغاصب حقوقهم ومنكر فضائلهم ومناقبهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد أوصيكم عباد الله بتقوى الله أوصيكم نفسي بتقوى الله والسلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته God weariness, God consciousness, I invite all of my dear brothers and sisters to be aware of this great phenomena, great reality which will come to our aid in the qabr, in the barzakh and in the hereafter. There's a story mentioned in one of the books which says that a person goes to a store, to shop, and it says CCTV everywhere. You're on CCTV. Everybody is watching you. And he goes inside. He tries to pay attention to. There were no cameras. And then finally he goes to the checkout. And he asks the guy who was, you know, the owner of the shop. You said CCTV, but I don't see anything. What do you do? He said, look up there. And he sees on top of the wall, it says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is CCTV. Allah is watching you all the time, wherever you are. If one got that CCTV in his heart, then he is protected from all sort of errors, all sins that one have to commit. So we just have to practice an exercise. And five times a prayer that we pray, this is an exercise for us to remind us that Allah is watching. Allah is Akbar. Allah is great. You know, how many times we say Allahu Akbar in our prayers? Before every sort of takbir, before every sort of movement, the change that we do, we say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. We remind us over and over again, you know, God is great. You know, that He is watching us. He is Sami, He is all listening, all hearing. You know, He's watchful, He is basir. So that's what taqwa means. You know, whenever we are in a sort of a wedding invite or a dinner or somewhere, if all of a sudden the cameraman comes, we are just very careful, you know. We don't take a big bite, you know. We don't speak. We control ourselves, right? You know, or when we are driving, speed limit 30, speed limit 40. How careful we are, right? If there is a camera, this camera is 24/7, right? So Allah Subhanahu wa Taala is always watching us. And let's pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this blessed day that Allah brings that God consciousness, God's weariness, that taqwa in our life, inshallah. Tabriq, felicitations, greetings, asadallah ayyamakum, the birth of Siddiqa Kubra, Fatimatu Zahra, salamu alayha. Congratulations to the Imam of our time, to all of the lovers of Fatimatu Zahra salamullah alayha, and to all of the mu'mineen and mu'minat, as a matter of fact, to all of humanity, because how important her birth is. A couple of things that I just want to dedicate today's sermon to her. There are three things which are quite important in a man's life. These are very important, regardless whether he be religious or not religious. You know, if we have these three things, these three phenomena to its utmost perfection, you know, his life is a great success. You know, he's successful. Number one is his genealogy. You know, his sort of roots and also his presence in his future children, right? That he should remain. You know, that's why, you know, we tend to look at that to have children and more children so that his name will remain, so that he remains somehow on this planet for a greater period of time. That is number one. Number two is his actions that he is known for. You know, he has done something marvelous that whenever that event happens, you know, 15th of August, the freedom of India from the British, for example, Gandhi is remembered, so to speak, although he died, you know, long time ago, 1947, and so on and so forth. An act that by which he is known and remained forever, something, the legacy that he has left behind. Through that, you know, he will remember, you know, people remember him. That's number two. Number three is that thought and ideology that one have left behind. And that ideology sort of works or remains for how many number, hundreds of years or whatever. You know, that communist thought, for example, that kind of eventually was shaken up, which was clearly seen by Imam Khomeini, because of which he writes that letter to Gorbachev saying that I could hear the bones of, you know, Lenin, sort of, I could hear that, you know, no communists no longer remain. So that thought that will remain for a, you know, greater period of time. That's number three. So when we look at, regardless of whether a person be religious or not religious, whether he believe in religion or he doesn't believe in religion, these three things are important, you know, whether, you know, he's a non-believer as well. So he has to be perfect in these three sort of portfolios for him to be known as a successful person. And who doesn't want to be the successful? You know, it's a desire of every person, Tom, Dick, and Harry, so to speak, right? Amr, Zaid, and Bakr, for example. So therefore, these three things, if they are intact and perfect, then obviously that will make him a greatest and successful person. When we look at the life of Siddiq-e-Kubra, if you look at, in terms of the genealogy, in terms of her children being remaining on this planet, Sadat, the Sayyids, how respectful they are, even till today. How Sayyids are respected. How they have remained even after such, so much persecution. After 1,400 and more years, I mean, if you open the books of history, you would not find any sort of family name, family last name that might have remained such for such a long period of time. And even after so much of persecution and zulm that have taken place upon Sadat, upon the Sayyids. But still, those Sayyids remained. Not only they just remain, they make an impact upon the globe. For example, today is also the birth, it coincides with the birth of Imam Khomeini. The birth of Imam Khomeini and the birth of Siddiq-e-Kubra is on the same day. So the Sayyid, the Sadat-e-Fatimi, you know, the Sayyid from that lineage comes and then, you know, makes that impact and reminds each and everybody that who really a true Sayyid is. You see? So that is success. That personality, you know, and look at that in an environment where there is no respect for women. In an environment where the girls are buried alive, there comes Siddiq-e-Kubra, and she is the mother of all Sadat. Whoever is Sayyid, this goes back to her. In an environment where the genealogy or, you know, the family runs through male rather than female, the Arabs, as well known, for example, of that time of Jahiliyyah, right? But here comes the Sadat is from a female. And they have remained for such a long period of time. This is nothing but the miracle of Siddiq-e-Kubra, Fatima Tuz-Zahra, Salamullah Alayha. The second is some sort of action that might have remained. Oh, this person has saved the train from the accident and he is well known in his whole village. Is recalled for that one action that he has provided. But when we look at the life of Siddiq-e-Kubra in terms of the legacy that she has left behind, beginning from those great sermons that we have, the khutbah of Hazrat Zahra that she has provided, that she has made, where great commentators have mentioned that this is hamkaf, this is the same way of the Nahjul Balagha of Amirul Mumineen, in terms of his eloquency, in terms of what it contains within it, from the ma'arif, from the knowledge of tawheed, from the knowledge of risalat and imamat and adalat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, really, this is fascinating and amazing what she has left behind in these sermons. You know, even after being once again a lady, coming out and giving and delivering these sermons and what it contains. It really requires us to investigate, to really familiar ourselves with these sermons of Siddiqa-e-Kubra. You know, have a deeper understanding of it and see how it affects our iman and our belief system. That's number one. Number two is the dua. You know, duas tend to be, a school of teaching tawheed. That's what the purpose of the dua is. And dua provides the vision and the insight of the reciter. The reciter, he raises himself to the level, to the proximity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so much that God speaks through his mouth. That's what dua is. Dua is nothing but God speaking through that personality. The duas of Sajjadiyah, Saif al-Sajjadiyah is that. When Imam have raised himself to that proximity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is contemplating, he is pondering upon these realities that is around him, like such as the day of Arafah. What is day of Arafah? What is the day of Friday? What is the day of Tuesday? Then Allah speaks through him. He has purified himself so much, then God speaks through him. And when he speaks, it is dictated and recorded. For example, the dua of Nur, which is famous of Siddiqa-e-Kubra, Bismillahir Nur. It is talking about Tawheed on all different levels, such as the Tawheed al-Zat, such as the Tawheed al-Sifat, the Tawheed al-Fail, which requires immense amount of philosophical arguments to really understand what are these three levels of Tawheed. Or, for example, the dua of Salam. Oh Allah, you are Salam. Anta Salam. Wa ilayka yaudu Salam. And Salam, you are Salam. Salam comes from you and Salam returns back to you. And the end of the day, it is nothing but Salam itself that remains. Wa yabaqa wajhika. As we recite in the Quran, Dhul Jalali wal Ikram, what remains and what is baqi is that the wajh, is that the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To really have this deeper understanding and the complexity of Tawheed really is amazing and fascinating, and where we find that she has that and she has left behind that legacy. And the final note is the tasbih that we recite. The very tasbih, regardless of which school you belong to, Shafi'i, Maliki, Hanbali, Shi'i, whatever, the tasbih is recorded in each and every school. And there is no difference in that. You pray this way, you pray this way, you pray that way. 34 times Allahu Akbar, 33 times Alhamdulillah, 33 times Subhanallah. It is amazing. And it is so much connected to that act of ibadat. Wajib, right after that, Tasbih-e-Fatima. I mean, it's just connect to that. This really points out to that how close she was to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that she had made this recommended as act so powerful that it exists in the whole Muslim ummah, in the whole Muslim world. And it doesn't end there. When we look at the champions of spirituality, such as the sixth Imam, Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Where he mentions that, to me, reciting the tasbih of my grandmother, Siddiqa-e-Kubra, is better than reciting 1,000 rakat of prayers. Just the tasbih. What is the purpose of everything that has been created? وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ Isn't it? That's what the Quran says. The purpose is that it makes us reach that proximity to God. The purpose of a car, no matter how expensive it is, no matter how beautiful or how flashy it is, if it doesn't make us reach our destination, it's useless. It's pointless. The cycle is better than that. The purpose is that it reach that destination. It should reach that target. You know, it's that bullseye. Now, the purpose of our salat, of our ibadat is that. Is what? Is that it? We gain that qurb. We gain that nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That two rakat of sunnah or wajib or whatever we are praying is to gain that qurb and that nearness. Now, when a person recites 1,000 and more rakat of prayers, how much near he will come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And 1,000 rakat and more, if he wants to recite, it will take more than 24 hours. But if he just recites the tasbih of Fatima after his prayers, he is targeting more. He is reaching much closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than 1,000 rakat of prayers. That is Fatima. This points out to the merciful nature that contains in the essence of Fatima. She is mercy to, the way how Father is mercy to mankind, rahmatul lil alameen. But the daughter in the traditions is known as mercy to the father, and the son is known as the ni'mat. When the rahmatul lil alameen, he is rahmatul lil alameen. For rahmatul lil alameen, Fatima is mercy. For rahmatul lil alameen, Fatima is mother, umme abiha. What maqam that she has. So as she got this essential quality of mercy in her, she leaves behind an act of a minute, tasbih, for all Muslim ummah, by which they could come closer to God. This is nothing but the mercy of Fatima that we have. That a person sits after he prayers and he recites this 5 minutes of tasbih with tawajjuh. Not Allah Akbar, Allah Akbar, Allah Akbar, Allah Akbar, Allah Akbar, Allah Akbar, how we recite, unfortunately. You know, last night, Brother Lakha, as he was mentioning, you know, when the diamonds are given to the children, you know, they will use it as pebbles and, you know, they don't really realize the value and worth of it. May Allah bless him. Right? But if a jeweler takes those diamonds, he realizes it. We got this tasbih of Fatima. Any issues, you know, they ask, Salman, I do tawaf of Kaaba every night. What do you do? I recite tasbih of Fatima every night. Where the tawaf of Kaaba takes me in terms of my qurb ila Allah, the tasbih of Fatima will take me there. Although I am not near in Makkah. That is tasbih of Fatima. What has happened to us? Where is the sunnah of tasbih gone? The miracles of tasbih been recorded. Why are we so preoccupied with our day-to-day activities? Why can't we really give 1 minute after our prayers and recite tasbih with a tawajjuh? Where are we heading? That is tasbih of Fatima. So, an action that one leaves behind. And this is something, as long as the salat will remain, the tasbih of Fatima will remain. And the salat will remain till the day of Qiyamah. So the tasbih of Fatima will remain till the day of Qiyamah. This is something that she has left behind. And the third and final thing that we see in regards to her is that ideology. Is that thought that she has left behind. Even the Prophet, I will go to the extent of saying that, did not leave that sort of clarity between haqq and batil. But she has laid the foundation of where is haqq and where is batil. And today it is clearly recorded. It is through her. The way mother protects the child and the honor of the child, the same way she has protected the honor and the mission and the purpose of the Prophet by laying the foundation of haqq and batil. As we are fully aware of that hadith, this is why she is known as mother. And this hadith, Umme Habiha, this title Umme Habiha, echoes in a different fashion from the 11th Imam, where the 11th Imam, Imam Hassan al-Askari alayhi salam, mentions that we are, hujjat, we are witness, we are hujjat. As we know that the purpose of hujjat is that if hujjat is there is sustenance, there is subsistence, there is baqa. Everything remains because of the hujjat. The 11th Imam says, we are hujjat. So as the 12th Imam is alive, he is hujjat, and because of him, everything exists. We are hujjat upon mankind, and Fatima is hujjat for us. So the hujjat is the hujjat. Hujjat requires an hujjat, and that hujjat is Fatima. And when Imam is saying, I will go to the extent of saying that, when Imam is saying that, Fatima is hujjat for us. Fatima is hujjat for the imamat. So Fatima is hujjat for Hazrat Amir as well. Because she is the protector. She is the definer of that wilayat. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ وَمَا فَاتِمَةَ as the sixth Imam clearly says, that who understands Fatima bihaqqi ma'rifati, he has understood what is Laylatul Qadr. So if somebody knows who Fatima is, but it is very difficult and comprehend, to really comprehend her wujud. Because when Prophet goes to the heaven, he was provided by that fruit. When did Prophet go to the heaven? Fourth of Be'asat, we have Asra bi Abdi Hilay, isn't it? Now look at this scenario. Iqra. Quran comes to the Prophet to announce. What does Quran do? Quran opens the paths towards the heaven, so that the Prophet reaches وَقَانَ قَابِ قَوْسَيْنَ أَوْ أَدْنَى. That's what Quran is. Iqra wa warqa. On the Day of Judgment, everybody will be asked to recite Quran, and they go higher and higher in terms of the levels of the Behisht, in terms of the level of the Jannah. So when they recite, they go higher. So it opens the doors of the heaven, a person goes higher and higher. Iqra comes, Be'athat, the Prophet comes, the Quran arrives, with the recitation, with the implementation, with the spiritual exercises mentioned to the Prophet from the Quran, for instance, he goes higher and higher, and he reaches وَقَانَ قَابِ قَوْسَيْنَ أَوْ أَدْنَى, Surah Najm, to that level of proximity to the divine, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Over there, Jibreel welcomes him and provides him with that fruit. And he opens, the nur comes out, and he was informed that, oh, Muhammad, we give you the glad tidings of a daughter who will be named Fatima on earth and Mansura in the heaven. I'm sorry. Now, for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to bring Fatima required that Quran, so that he reached to that higher level. He reaches there to Miraj and brings Fatima from there. So Fatima, wa ma adraka Fatima. It really needed that Quran. It really needed that spirit. The same way as the heart of the Prophet required for the Quran to descend. It is not possible for any human being to really take the Quran on his heart. But it was the Prophet, Rahmatulil Alameen. So it required the journey of the Prophet towards the heaven to bring Fatima down. Right? And then the hadith continues. She is known as Mansura in the heaven. And she is known as Fatima. Then Prophet asked, what does Fatima mean? Jibreel says, Fatima, which comes from Fatim, which means cut off. She is cut off from all impurities. She is cut off from all ignorance. She is cut off from the hellfire. She is cut off from the enemies of her, so that they do not enter paradise. And the lovers of Fatima and Fatima are cut off from the hellfire. That is why she is known as Fatima on earth. And she is known as Mansura in the heaven. Why is that? Because she is the Nasr. She is the helper of the divine dwellers who are in the heaven. She is the helper of the angels. She is the helper of that purpose of God. That is why she is known as Mansura. Now I will put the hadith, the other title of Siddiqah Kubra. And that is, she is known as Zahra. When she stands in the mihrab, her nur illuminates to the heaven and it becomes light. Although the divine bodies, the divine existence are already light. So what sort of greater light really is the light of Fatima that shines for those who are already light? What is the purpose of light? Inna al-Husayn Mizbahul Huda. He is known as the Mizbah. He is known as light. The purpose of light is to guide, is to open the path. So it is the nur of Fatima which really opens the paths to the malaika to really comprehend and understand what La ilaha illallah really means. That is the nur of Fatima. That is why we say, Bi'abiha wa baliha wa baniha wa sirril mustawdi' fiha. That sir, that secret that is within Fatima. What is that? Wa madrak. What is that sir? What is that secret in Fatima? We don't really know. It is really difficult to comprehend and understand and realize where the kulli iman, where Amirul Mu'mineen says, my nafs, my ruh, be sacrificed to you, O Fatima. Where the Prophet says, Fatima is the ruh bayna jambay. She is the spirit in this heart. Wa nafaqtu fiha min ruhi. Wa ma adraka. When you ask about ruh, it says, do not ask about ruh. You know, it will not be able to understand what ruh is. And the Prophet is saying, she is the ruh. One really cannot comprehend this wujud. We've been blessed with it. It really requires that ma'rifat and understanding who she is, who she was. When she is Fatim, when she is Fatima in this earth, when the earth is annihilated, when the earth destroys, she becomes that Mansura in the heaven and plays that role of Mansura in Jannah, in Barzakh, for her lovers. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we all be from the true lovers of Siddiqah Kubra, and that we be provided from those that she chooses us from among all of them, and take us to the Jannah, and that we dwell with Jibari Nabiyyika alayhi salam. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qul huwallahu ahad. Allahu samad. Lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakun lahu kufuwan ahad. Sadaqallahu al-aliyyul azim. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا حبيب إله رب العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم اللهم صل وسلم على أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب عليه السلام وصلي على صديقه كبرى فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين وصلي على سبتي رحمه وإمام الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدة شباب أهل الجنة وصلي على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين زين العابدين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وجعلنا من أوانه وأنصاره أوصيكم عباد الله بتقوى الله أوصيكم نفسي بتقوى الله. Once again I invite all of my dear brothers and sisters and myself to practice تقوى. والسلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Once again, the 12th Imam says that the uswa, the role model for me, is Fatima. She is my role model. The imam who is the hujjat, he says. To continue on as being the birth of Siddiqah Kubra, I would dedicate part of this couple of minutes as well to her as well, just to remind and recall the saga of her birth, the way the birth took place. As the Prophet was given that fruit, and then in return, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Prophet, when you go back, give salam to Khatija. Look at the maqam of her, of Khatija al-Kubra. That Allah is saying, give my salam to her. You know, this is the manzilat. This is the lofty station of Khatija al-Kubra. Salamullah alayha. Give my salams. Now, if we just pay attention to this whole sort of incident and event, the fruit, and then the salam comes from the heaven, and salam rises from her as well. Peace and blessing for the mankind, which is Fatima. The salam was brought, and salam was given back by Khatija Kubra, salamullah alayha. That's what the deeper meaning of this salam is. Salim, free from all limitations and fault. That is Fatima, salamullah alayha. As we all know that she was heavily boycotted. They cut the relationship as she got married to the Prophet. There was no helper for her, because at that hour when she needed the most, she sent an emissary note to the ladies of Quraysh. In return, they said that as you married to this orphan, as you sacrifice all your mal, all your property for him, we will not help you. See, Rasul is Habib of Allah. And look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attends to the Habib, as there are other traditions as well in regards to in what style Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Rasul. And what did he see there in terms of the wilayat? Amirul Mumineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. This Habib, he's Habib-e Khuda. You know, he's Habib-e Khuda, right? He's the beloved of Allah. So someone who we really love, we want him the best. So that type of welcome, Fatima been given as well. And now Khadija salamullah alayha, who have served Hal Jazaul Ahsan illa al-Ahsan. Allah returns that ahsan by giving Fatima to Khadija, and how Khadija is remained Ummul Mumineen. So here she called for help, nobody comes, but the time comes, the heavenly bodies appear from the heaven, Nuzul of four great ladies, Hazrat Maryam, Hazrat Asiya, the wife of Fir'aun, Hazrat Kulsum, the daughter of Musa, and Hazrat Sarah. As they say, Alladina Amanu, those who believe, رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ إِنَ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَىٰ وَإِسْتِقَامُ, and they resist. And the malaika will descend and will say, لَا تَخَفْ, do not be afraid. Do not fear. وَلَا تَحْزُنْ, and do not be sorrow. Because Khadija was in that state of sorrow. No helpers. No, wasn't there. No one was there. And here comes Sarah. These four heavenly bodies that does the nuzul. And then they aid Khatijatul Kubra and brought Hazrat Fatima Zahra Salamullah Alayha. So these are the traditions which are recorded. Salat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And our belief on them, inshallah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us all with Ahl Bayt alayhimus salam. Couple of things very quick. I have to end in 3-4 minutes so that we start our prayers 5 minutes to 1. The pollution level is number 10. It's been recorded today, and today is the highest. So my request to all my elders and all my youngsters who are suffering from heart and asthma and all that, they should be very careful in terms of the activities. The pollution level is 10. It was recorded in BBC. I was just checking this morning. So be very careful, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect you all. See, why? Environment is amanat given to us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have to take care of the environment. It is an amana. We have to be careful, you know, in terms of how we make use of this environment. Unfortunately, with sort of modern time that we live in, with sort of technology, with sort of capitalism that is there, dumping all waste in the oceans, destroying the life, the ozone layer, the pollution of the smog, all of these things, where it has come from. Those who have really thought of their pockets, those who have really thought of occupation and expansion of their own sort of agenda or ideologies, they have really hampered the environment, and it has become precarious and very dangerous for not only, you know, the plant life or animal life, or even for human beings. We all are suffering from that act. You know, previously, as we all know, those scientists and scholars, they were keeping God in the equation. But after Renaissance, they have taken God out of the equation. And they have only thought of their empirical progress. They only thought of the worldly progress or the material progress. If they have put up God in the equation, they would have never made nuclear bomb. Because it destroys humanity. It destroys mankind. Islam doesn't want anyone to be destroyed. It is wrong. It is against that principle. A research, a development, an invention which benefits mankind, it is betterment. So therefore, what we see today is its fruits, unfortunately. And today that we need to warn our, you know, seniors and our brothers and sisters in regards to that. Two things, the genocide in Yemen, unfortunately, 16 days continuous, Saudis are attacking. It's up in the news everywhere. However, there are issues in regards to the Houthis mob and how they are trying to take revenge, which is also wrong. You know, it shouldn't be carried out. That is wrong as well. Islam really doesn't allow that. You know, if they come in power, so they should burn the houses and so on and so forth. You know, same thing in Tikrit. You know, they have blamed Shia mob destroying the homes and so on and so forth. But over there, having said that, we have to really read a bit much closer, because they were remnants. They were things remained, you know, houses remained which belongs to the ISIS, which they had to destroy it in that fashion. Even CNN reports that. But having said that as well, we have seen certain sort of, you know, houses being burned, head being severed. This is not Islam. This is not the way. You know, it is, unfortunately, the mob, the destruction, the burning, you know, it has become the part and parcel of political agenda of the society, which Islam really, you know, doesn't like that. Islam really condemns these acts. So what it requires is the teachings of Islam and the teachings of Ahl Bayt to be implemented in the followers who say Ya Ali, in their followers, so that, you know, these sort of all, you know, wrong acts must not take place, where innocent lives are taken, regardless. You know, innocent life is an innocent life. So it is very much that we pay attention to these things, that we remind us that, you know, when Amirul Mumineen, he was injured, when he wakes up from his unconsciousness, he asks, I could hear Ibn Muljim, is he alright? You know, this is the logic. This is the method that Ahl Bayt taught us. You know, when the fourth Imam provides that water to the killer of Ali Asghar in the desert, he said, I know you. You are one of them who killed my own son. Right? This is how Ahl Bayt alayhimus salam were, in terms of the enemies as well. Right? So therefore, in terms of those who are the followers of Ahl Bayt alayhimus salam, they should behave in this fashion, and that is what is very much required, you know, by our Muslim brothers, by our, you know, by the followers of Ahl Bayt alayhimus salam, no matter where they live, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us strength and tawfiq to implement the teachings of Ahl Bayt in our life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect the life, honor, dignity of the lovers of Zahra, no matter where they live in this world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala haste the reappearance of our 12th Imam, include us as the faithful companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our Maraj-e-Izam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our elderly ones, protect our young ones. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give shifa to Jumla Mumineen and Mu'minat, especially those who have requested us for prayers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provide us with a special blessing upon this day of birth of Siddiqa-e-Kubra as a gift from her. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins, the sins of our marhumeen, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase the darja of our marhumeen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asr inna l-insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa aminu s-salihati wa tawasu bil haq wa tawasu bil sabr. Sadaqallahu l-alayhi wa l-adhim.